welcome everybody here this morning. Glad you could make it out. I hope you're ready to worship God here this morning and just fellowship with one another and hear a message from the Word. And let's start off with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for the opportunity we have to be here, the freedoms we enjoy to be able to gather freely like this. And I just pray that you'll bless our time here this morning, that you will just, even now, be putting our hearts into the right place. Help us to put aside the business of the week, of just things that are going on in our lives that may be distractions to us, but help us to put them aside, to give them over to you, and to be able to focus on you here this morning. And as Pastor Bruce brings a message, that you will speak to us through that as well. And just as we offer up our praises through singing, that just put our hearts in the right place and help us to put our pride aside and just to fully concentrate and give our praise to you, because certainly you are deserving of it. And I just pray in everything we do here this morning that we can point towards you and just help keep our focus on you this morning. In Jesus' name.
Amen. So good to see your smiling faces. Why don't you please stand? We're here to worship our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's do that with open hearts. We're going to sing about His grace this morning.
Grace, grace, how grace.
it's been a while, but it tells a true story, or the full story of the believer, from the blind man to the woman at the well, Lazarus being raised from the dead, and finally Jesus Christ and our belief in him. And he is the way, the truth, and the life. Let's sing.
Roll and grind.
we take a look at our bulletins here. We will be having our adult Bible study this week at 6:30 on Tuesday. Maybe 6:45 is probably a more accurate starting time. The work day you see in there that says Thursday, that's actually being changed this week to Wednesday. So Wednesday at 9 will be the work day this week. And they're coming in to hook up some of the audio stuff there on Thursday. That's why the change. And they don't really want people around, so try not to be here on Thursday. Just looking ahead a little bit to some of the other things coming up. The last day of Sunday school would be May 23rd, which also happens to be my birthday. I recognize the day. You can see there's some other camps and stuff coming up. There's a high school retreat at the Wilderness School of the Bible, and then camps at Big Sky and also at Utmost this summer. There's info on the front table there for the Big Sky camps, and you can look on the internet and find the Utmost camps as well. I think it's getting to be time to sign up for those if you're interested. So, and then also Vacation Bible School is coming up, so even now you can be praying for that and thinking how you might be involved in with that. And so I guess that's what I have for announcements here this morning. Let's take a look at our birthdays. On the 4th, we have Marilyn Nancy. She's probably still down in Alabama, but if she's watching on the video, we'll wish her a happy birthday this week. And then on the 16th, we have Donna. Let's see him either. So I guess we can wish Donna a happy birthday this week. Why don't we sing? I guess I could ask, is there any other birthdays this week that we're missing? Let's sing. Too. We have Bill and Lynn Shute this week, but back in that corner, I know they're probably not here. But if you see Bill or Lynn this week, you can wish them a happy anniversary. I guess we also want to take the time, if there's any first-time Berg visitors, just like to know who you are, if you don't mind letting us know that.
This is my brother, Stephen. He's visiting from Florida.
Okay, with that, we'll move to our scripture reading here this morning. I'm going to read from John, the 20th chapter, starting at verse 19. But before we read the scripture, let's go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your scripture that you've given to us, and as we read it this morning, I pray that you will just speak to us through the words that you give us here. In Jesus' name. So again, John chapter 20, starting at verse 19. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After this, he said, he showed his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." So this, this is the story of, that started on Easter, I guess, in the evening of that, the day when Jesus was resurrected. At that point, the disciples were in a room with the doors locked. They were kind of scared that if they had come after Jesus as his followers, they were going to be coming after them too. And And, you know, so they're sitting there, and you can just kind of imagine the fear, trepidation that maybe they were feeling. I mean, they did earlier in the day. Jesus had appeared to Mary Magdalene, Peter and John, and went to the tomb and saw that it was open. But, you know, for the disciples themselves, they hadn't seen Jesus yet. And so he appears to them, and, you know, he just kind of appeared in the room. The doors were locked, but, you know, all of a sudden, there's Jesus with them. And he says to them, "Peace be with you." And, you know, I'm sure for them, that was something they needed. You know, this would have been a trying time for them. And, you know, after that, he shows his hands, his feet, his side, you know, that they were pierced, that they could know that it was really Jesus, and he really was resurrected from the dead. And then again, in verse 21, he repeats to them, "Peace be with you." And then, you know, this next part here was, in a sense, really the key. "As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." So, then, you know, this is a little different than the Great Commission in Matthew. I mean, I think that came a little bit later in the chronology of time. But it's really the same message that Jesus was giving him, the disciples here. That, you know, the time was ending for them to be cloistered and, you know, in fear. But he was, you know, saying, I'm speaking peace be with you. And from that, you know, it is the Father sent me here to the earth, I'm sending you out. And then he, you know, he follows that by telling them to receive the Holy Spirit. And, you know, they wouldn't, I guess, get the full implementation of that until the day of Pentecost, when, you know, when this Holy Spirit came down with tongues of fire, and you know, they really caught fire. But, you know, this was the beginning with it. And so we can see, you know, immediately after Jesus had accomplished the work on the cross of, you know, making us right before God, I mean, he was, you know, the first message he gives to his disciples is to go out. And, you know, that message hasn't changed for us today. And, you know, it's something that we need to, I guess, just be cognizant of and do as we get the chance to, you know, to spread the message of the gospel. So with that, we'll move to our prayer time. I think we get a few requests here this morning. Brian Anderson is going to be having surgery this week. And I think it's, you know, fixed some of the stuff from when he was in there before. They're hooking him back up, is the way Nathan put it. So I think it's a, you know, it's a good step in the process. But, you know, anytime there's surgery going on, you know, he can certainly use our prayers. Deb Krantz has a prayer request for good results of an MRI of the brain. So I guess you're going in for a test and pray that it comes back that good and there's something up there at least. Not to be doubted. And there's also, we had a request that somebody's having an adverse reaction to the COVID and the vaccine of COVID. And hopefully it's a short thing. I had the same thing happen to me this week. It was one day and it was done. So we'll pray for this person. I think, you know, there may be others as well that, you know, when you get that vaccine, it can give you a nasty reaction the first day or two. So let's take these things to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the way you provide for us in our lives. We thank you for this plan of salvation that you had for us that we celebrated last week with Jesus dying on the cross, but not remaining there. He rose again, and through that, it was as if we died and were rose with a victory over sin. And I pray that we can live our lives like that, and that you will let us not just stop there in that victory, but to send us out as well and give us opportunities to share that with those who don't believe. We do want to lift up Brian as he goes in for surgery this week. We just pray that your healing touch will be on him. We just pray that you'll guide the doctor's hands, and if it be in your will, that you just put your healing touch on him and just get him to quickly be on the path to recovery. We lift up Deb as she goes in for this test this week. We just pray that your guidance will be there. We pray that there will be nothing there adverse to be found, and that it'll be a good result back. But we also pray that if there is anything, that you would just open the doctor's eyes to it, and it can be handled quickly. But we just pray for your will to be done there, and just give Deb a peace about it as well. And we just pray for a good result there. And for this friend who's having a bad reaction to the COVID vaccine, we just pray just for your touch there, and just that it will do what it's intended to, and that this adverse reaction will be quickly put behind them. And just for other requests that weren't here this morning, I just I know there's others who are struggling with physical issues. We just lift them up to you this morning. I just think of Ann and Lanny's family as they mourn the passing of Stan, and you would just give your comfort to that family and just help them to be able to celebrate the life that he did have, but comfort them in their time of loss as well. We lift up our country to you. We just pray for our leaders. We pray that you would change hearts, that you would give them your wisdom in making decisions and things that happen for this country. We pray for your church. We just pray that you will just strengthen the leaders, the teachers, the pastors especially, and just keep them true to the word that you've given them in your word. And I just pray for all the church, that you would spark a revival, that you would draw people to you, that you would get people on fire for you. And we just pray that might not just stay within the church, but it would spread out to those who are lost as well. We lift up those who serve you in places of that puts perhaps their own lives in danger, whether it be military or police, the first responders. We just pray for your protection for them. We just pray, we thank you for what they do, and we pray a protection for them and for their families as well. And once again, God, just any other requests that were unspoken here this morning, we know you hear our prayers, and we just pray that you'll give us a heart of always looking to you with our concerns, and we thank you that you hear those things and that you do listen to us. And I just pray now as we continue on here in the service that you'll put your blessing on all that happens here this morning. In Jesus' name. Okay.
Once again, would you please stand? Turn in your hymnals to number 415, 415. Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not but my Lord was crucified, knowing not it was for me he died on Calvary.
Thank you. for joining us here today. I want to welcome those of you that will be watching this later this week on YouTube. We're glad that you're able to do that, but we miss you and we're looking forward to seeing you again. So we're going to continue our worship service now by taking an offering. And let's see, Lonnie, why don't you and Chuck come up? You just right there handy in that one row. And just give me a hand, please. Lonnie, why don't you come on up there and offer a prayer? Chuck.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful that you have brought us all together here today to hear Pastor Bruce's word. We ask that you open our minds, our hearts, and use your will to allow us to discern your word. Today we bring gifts to you and we ask that you use them to enhance your kingdom and to help us again to understand more about you and your kingdom. In your name we pray.
Jeremiah. We're going to take a look at some verses, and actually we're going to look at some verses in Jeremiah 1 just briefly, and then most of this morning will be in Jeremiah 46 and 47. Also take a look at some verses in Matthew 7 if you want to hold that or turn to it when we get there. Those of you that are U.S. history scholars, and if you're not, I would urge you to become one. Learn something about the history of this country. The Bible first, but then U.S. history second. And if you are, you will understand that the correspondence that President Jefferson received from the Danbury Baptist Church in Connecticut, their concern was that Connecticut as a state might establish a state religion, force them to adhere to a religion that was established by the state. And so they wrote to Jefferson about that concern, and if you read Jefferson's reply, I think it would become apparent to you that this phrase, separation of church and state, and Jefferson did talk about a wall of separation between the church and the state, but it was there to protect the church from overly being influenced by the state. Not the other way around. There was nothing about it that was intended to insulate our government from the influence of the church. But we should also understand and acknowledge, because it comes from Scripture, that the relationship of the realm of the church and the secular realm of the political state has always been an uneasy one. The Bible tells us also that there is this principle of a separation between the sacred and the secular. Jesus clarified this in Matthew 22 and chapter 22, verse 21, when he said, "Give back to Caesar what is Caesar's, give to God what is God." Government should never interfere with the free exercise of religion. And the church should never try to use politics to advance their worldly power. Christians have a right and a responsibility to hold government accountable for acts of injustice. This means that when government sins against God, when it sins against humanity, God's people, no matter where they live, must speak out. They must hold government accountable. As Christians, we have a vote and we have a voice. And far too often as a group, we fail to exercise that power that we have. And we fail to exercise it when we don't pray for those who have put in positions of authority, whether it's local, whether it's state, or whether it's our federal government. Throughout this book of Jeremiah, we've seen the prophet living out these very principles. He has spoken out against the sins of government and of the people, living as it was, as Scripture tells us we're to do, living as salt and light in a decaying and darkening culture. For more than four decades now, Jeremiah has labored tirelessly. He spoke boldly, and he's prayed constantly for the repentance and the restoration of his nation. But now we come to chapters in the book where the kingdom of Judah is no more. No more. It's been conquered by the Babylonians. Those who weren't killed were carried off in captivity to Babylon. The tiny remnant, a few of the poorest people that were left in Judah, we discussed that last week. In opposition to God's will, they ran off to Egypt. That's the state we come to today in our message. But the prophet's work's not done. Even though he's been carried off to Egypt against his will, Jeremiah continues to preach a message of repentance to the refugees of this fallen nation. And he's about ready to take his message of repentance from the national level to the international stage. God is now calling Jeremiah to confront the nations of the world. And this book of Jeremiah is going to close with a series of messages to these foreign nations. This is where we need to take a look at Jeremiah chapter 1 again, because when God first called Jeremiah to be a prophet, he promised that Jeremiah would not only prophesy to the nation of Judah, but that he would have authority over the nations around Judah. So we'll start off looking at Jeremiah chapter 1, verses 9 and 10. But as always, before we go to Scripture, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, I do lift this time up to you, Lord, and today we look at some verses that at first blush we may just see as historical, we may just see as political, and we struggle to understand the spiritual message, Father, but there's always one there. So I would ask now that you would open our eyes to look deeper, to look beyond the surface, and to see how these verses affect us as individuals, us as a nation, and our world today, Father. And I pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Jeremiah chapter 1, and beginning in verse 9, the Lord reached out his hand and touched my mouth, and he said to me, "I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and kingdoms to uproot and tear down, to destroy and overthrow, to build and to plant." Now, again, in these last chapters of Jeremiah, we're going to come to the fulfillment of these prophecies. To date, Jeremiah's prophecies have been for the nation of Judah. Now we're going to see that he has a message for those nations that surround Israel regarding their destinies. Jeremiah's not the only prophet to deliver warnings to the Gentile nations. You can find similar prophetic messages in the book of Isaiah and the book of Ezekiel. And I want to point out, now taken together, these sets of these prophetic messages to the Gentile nations combine an important section of Scripture. I'm taking a chance here, folks, because I'm going to take us to a part of the Bible that when you have read through it, you probably said, well, that's nice, that's historical, but it's happened, it's over, and it's done with. But that would be a mistake to do that, and I'm going to try to explain that a little deeper as we go on here. Again, as Christians today, we're just tempted to somewhat ignore these verses, read over them quickly with very little thought. Because they're what our good friend Pastor Jim Carlson would call the clean pages of the Bible. It's not pages you've turned to a lot. It's not pages that you have marked up with a highlighter because you want to go back and look at them over and over again. But they're important. It's important to know what God said to these nations. The message Jeremiah delivered to these nations in his day is still God's urgent warnings to nations today. I have reminded you as we've gone through this book of Jeremiah that I had two primary reasons. First off, I wanted to draw out the parallels that I think are obvious to what was going on in Judah and Jeremiah's time and what is going on in our nation and in our world today. Secondly, I wanted to encourage you to take a closer look at this book, to read through it, inspired by God's Holy Spirit, and to get to a level that you may not have gotten to. A great example for what's going on here now in these prophecies to these foreign nations would be found in Revelations chapter 2 and 3. If you were to take a look at Revelation, and there you see Jesus speaking prophetically to seven churches in Asia Minor. And if you just read through that, you say, okay, those were churches that actually existed at that time. God had something to say about each and every one of them. He had a warning for them. But it would be a mistake to say it was just applicable to those churches. The spiritual message that is in those two chapters is for God's church everywhere, through all time. And that's what we find in these messages to the nations today. It is for nations everywhere, through all time. And I'm going to try to draw out some of the spiritual implications, not just for nations, but for individuals today. Now, on the surface, again, Jeremiah's message is historical and it's political. But these prophecies have to do with actual kingdoms that existed at specific times in history. And God is speaking through the prophet and has made specific announcements about each one of these nations. We'll find, this will end up being at least a two-part message, but we'll find that four of these countries continue to exist today, and God has promised a blessing on each one of them. Two of the nations also continue to exist today, but we see no blessing pronounced from God. And three of the nations that we're going to talk about have disappeared. They have been removed from the face of the earth. They no longer exist, lost to history. And this is another point that I think we need to make while we're at this time. When we tend to read through the Old Testament, so much of it has to do with God's work in the nation of Israel. But I think when we get to points like this, we can come to understand that God has been at work everywhere through all times. We see that He is involved in other nations in the Old Testament, not just the nation of Israel. And we want to dig beneath the surface of Jeremiah's messages here, and again, we find a second level of meaning. I've already said it, but I'll remind you that we can apply to our lives today. The second level can be understood to symbolize the spiritual forces that are at work within all of us. One of the clues to understanding the Word of God is to see ourselves And in this case, to see our nation, whenever we read about Jeremiah's prophecies to these nations 2,600 years ago, we can better understand our own deceptive flesh and how it tempts us to sin as we examine the national character of these kingdoms. So first, and the one we'll spend most of our time on today, is the nation of Egypt. Historically, about 605 BC, the Babylonians and the Egyptians met at the Battle of Carchemish. And that was one of the most important battles in ancient history. Prior to that battle, Egypt had been, they'd been the bull of the walk. They'd been the top country in the world, most powerful. Babylonians defeated them at this battle, and then the Babylonian Empire arose to be the superpower of the world at that time. In Jeremiah 46, if you want to turn over there, Jeremiah 46, verses 7 and 8, we'll see that God uses historically accurate language to describe Egypt in terms of its national character and its behavior. Looking beneath the surface of this description, we see that Egypt is a symbolic picture of the world and its influence upon us. God's description of Egypt is that of a nation filled with worldly pride, worldly arrogance, worldly ambition. In other words, human pride at a national corporate level. God said through the prophet, Jeremiah 46, and beginning in verse 7, "Who is this that rises like the Nile, like rivers of surging water? Egypt rises like the Nile, like rivers of surging water. She says, I will rise and cover the earth. I will destroy cities and their people." Now again, throughout Scripture, Egypt serves as a symbol of worldly pride and worldly arrogance. And Egypt is a fitting symbol of how the world lures believers into their grasp. Even though we profess to be Christians, even though we have given our life to the Lord, Satan still tries to draw us back into these worldly influences. And when we yield ourselves to the world and its pleasures, we end up in bondage, unable to free ourselves from habits, fears, addictions, those things that keep us enslaved. You know, there's nothing wrong, don't get me wrong, there's nothing wrong with enjoying the pleasures of life, as long as you enjoy life's pleasures in the context of seeking God, seeking His kingdom, seeking His righteousness. Now at the end of this chapter, the end of chapter 46 and beginning in verse 25, God makes what I kind of find to be at first a strange statement regarding this nation of Egypt. 46:25. "The Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says, I am about to bring punishment on Amon, the god of Tabiz, on Pharaoh, on Egypt, on her god, on her kings, on those who rely on Pharaoh. I will give them into the hands of those who want to kill them, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, and his officers. Later, however, Egypt will be inhabited as in times past, declares the Lord." So this prophecy was at least partially fulfilled in 567 BC. That's when Babylonian king Nebuchadnezzar invaded Egypt. He conquered much of the Nile Valley, and he literally humiliated Pharaoh. And I want to point out, if you were here last week and you remember, we had this discussion about this remnant of Israelites that were left in Judah and determined against God's will that they were going to go to Egypt. And God said, you are going to be under a curse. You're going to be punishment. The sword and famine is going to follow you there. And that's what we see occurred here in 567 B.C. when Egypt fell to the Babylonians and the Jews that were there were caught up in it at the time. But interestingly, at the end of these verses, he also says that Egypt will one day be restored and inhabited. I would agree with those that make the argument that at least for some of us, we've seen this happen in our lifetime. 1952. You see, for centuries and through the Middle Ages, the Egyptians were subjugated to the Ottoman Empire. From the 7th century AD through most of the 19th century, Egypt was a nation literally asleep. After the Ottoman Empire fell from about 1867 until the start of World War I in 1914, Europe literally trampled Egypt underfoot. They ransacked Egyptian pyramids and other antiquities, and they displayed their findings in the European museums. Great Britain held Egypt as a protectorate from 1882 until 1952. And in 1952, a guy named Nasser took over in a military coup, and he eventually became the dictator. And he was a strong man, but he was also very oppressive. But Egypt did awaken at that time. It once again became a sovereign nation. And in Jeremiah's message to Egypt, God promised to spare Egypt and cause the land to be inhabited once more. You can also find a similar prophecy again about Egypt in Isaiah 19, where God says that Egypt will be healed and that God will bless the Egyptians and call them his people. If you were to study church history from the end of the Bible, okay, and over the centuries until present, you would find that in the early centuries of Christianity, the two most prominent places in the world regarding Christian studies, one was Alexandria, Egypt, and the other was Antioch. And so God did bless the Egyptians in that regard, and I would say that it was a long time before the prophecy was fulfilled, but by 1952 he had reestablished them again as a nation. Do you see something that is kind of going on here? When you study history, you may be studying a secular book on history, but this is God's work in the world. This is God's work with humanity. He has been involved in every bit of it, and I think it's important for us to come to understand that, especially when we're trying to understand and look at our world today. In chapter 47, Jeremiah delivers a message from God to a nation that is very closely related to Egypt. That's the Philistines. And until the rise of the Assyrians, the Philistines had been the principal enemy of Israel. If you read through the book of Kings, the book of Chronicles, you're going to find Israel constantly at warfare for centuries against the Philistines. They've been perpetual enemies for hundreds of years. The Philistines lived along the southern coastline of the land of Palestine, and actually the name Palestine is derived from the word Philistine. The Philistines, this is very interesting, the Philistines were in the land that God had promised to his people, the land that God had promised to the Jews. But these hostile people were actually enemies of God. And they're symbolic, folks, today to individuals who claim to have a place in the land of promise, but who are actually enemies of faith, enemies of God. We might equate them to false Christians, people who claim to be Christian, but actually subvert or oppose true faith. Jesus told us in spoke of this very thing, Matthew 7, verse 15, when he said, "Beware of the false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves." You see, and I have to think about our country. consider this. These are people who want to enjoy living in a place that God has blessed. Again, I challenge you to find a nation anywhere at any time in history that is more blessed than this country.
Yeah.
And people want to live here, and maybe they don't realize that they want to live here because we are blessed by God the way we are, but they do want to live here, but they absolutely reject God. What a symbolic parallel to the Philistine people in the days of Jeremiah. They refused to commit themselves in any godly way to the God that has produced those blessings. We have God's prophecy going right to the point on the Philistines in chapter 47, verse 4. There he says, "For the day has come to destroy all Philistines, to remove all survivors who could help Tyre and Sidon. The Lord is about to destroy the Philistines and the remnants of the coast of Kaphtor." This prophecy speaks of a coming invasion by an unnamed army, an invasion that will mean the end of the nation and the peoples of the Philistines. The Philistines were conquered by the Assyrians and were later absorbed by the Babylonians and the Persians. By about 600 BC, there were no remnants of the Philistine ethnic group in the region. They had ceased to exist, just as God predicted. Just as an aside here that I find a little bit interesting, I don't think much historical data to support it, but some Palestinians, you're familiar with Palestinians, some Palestinians today claim to be descendants of the Philistines. I find it interesting. They live along the same area, Gaza. That was the area that was home to the Philistines 2,600 years ago, and they're in a perpetual state of war against Israel. God's work in the history of the world. So next week we're going to continue to look at some more of these prophecies against the nation, and we're also going to close this study on the book of Jeremiah. So I encourage you folks, I know some of you have gone back and you've read Jeremiah, and I'm glad that you have. I would encourage you to look at these last chapters from 46 on and just pray that God would open your eyes, your mind, your heart to the symbolism that we find here, because it is important. And if you can bring yourself to that point, you're going to garner a lot more out of your Bible reading than perhaps you are right now. Do you know him? Do you know him? Do you love him? Have you given your life to him? I hope so. I'm going to ask you to continue to pray for revival. Revival in our country, but particularly revival in our churches. And it can start right here in this church, in this congregation. If you've chosen a group of people or an individual to pray for, I'd ask you to continue to do that. I'm going to remind you to pray for our missionaries. Missionaries that we support, missionaries that we don't know. Pray for them. Lift them up, hold them up. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this time that you have given us to spend together, Lord. And I just pray that through the truths that we find in your scripture, that it would just affect our lives, Father, that we would just be more on fire every day to go out and to speak to others about our love and devotion to you, to share with others what you have done in our lives, Father. And Father, I thank you for this body of believers. I thank you for what a beacon of truth it is in this little valley here, Father. And pray that we continue. Pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to have a closing hymn, and then Leon, would you dismiss us with a closing prayer, please?
Please stand once more and turn in your hymnals to number 105, Grace Greater Than All Our Sin.
Father, we do thank you for that grace that extends far beyond all our sins. And I pray that you will help us to live victoriously in the midst of that grace that you've given to us. Help us to defeat sin in our lives. Help us to live holy lives that you called us to. I pray as we go out this week that you will help us to ponder the message that Pastor Bruce brought to us today, to think about, you know, how proclamations to countries years ago, how that can impact our lives even today. Help us to think about those things. Help us to meditate on the word that you've given to us. I pray that you will just guide us along the path that you have for us this week. Help us to be bold to proclaim the gospel if we should get the chance. And just help us to show love to each and every person that we come across in our lives this week. And we just pray for the power of your Holy Spirit to go out with us now and help us to live victorious lives. In Jesus' name.